In all the places that life and circumstance have taken us, we still know unity as the body of Christ in the gift of baptism. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation.
Amen.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit. Renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you, O God, be honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
The grace of the risen Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of new days, we give you thanks for the gift of your Christ and the gift of resurrection we share in him. Bless us with the gift of your presence on the journey as we make our way together.
Amen.
A reading from Maccabees. At daybreak, Judas appeared in the plain with 3,000 men, but they did not have armor and swords such as they desired. And they saw the camp of the Gentiles strong and fortified, with cavalry all around it, and these men were trained in war. But Judas said to those who were with him, "Do not fear their numbers or be afraid when they charge. Remember how our ancestors were saved at the Red Sea when Pharaoh with his forces pursued them. And now let us cry to heaven to see whether he will favor us and remember his covenant with our ancestors and crush this army before us today. Then all the Gentiles will know that there is one who redeems and saves Israel." Just as Judas was finishing this speech, a detachment appeared coming out of the hills. They saw that their army had been put to flight and that the Jews were burning the camp. for the smoke that was seen showed what had happened. When they perceived this, they were greatly frightened, and when they saw the army of Judas drawn up in the plain for battle, they all fled into the land of the Philistines. Then Judas returned to plunder the camp, and they seized a great amount of gold and silver, and cloth dyed blue and sea purple, and great riches. On their return, they sang hymns and praises to heaven, "For he is good, for his mercy endures forever." Thus Israel had a great deliverance that day. Here ends the reading.
I will be exalted among the nations. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth be moved, and though the mountains shake in the depths of the sea. Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult, I will be exalted among the nations. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city, it shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day. I will be exalted among the nations. Be still then, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. I will be exalted among the nations.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 24th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other as you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. One of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he asked them, "What things?" And they replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group surrounded us. They said they were at the tomb early that morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' And then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. And then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he's appeared to Simon." And then they told what had happened on the road and how Christ had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Hi, kids. I'm so glad that you're joining us for worship this morning, and we're so glad that you're here. I was thinking this week, maybe you've seen people wearing masks like this. Some of them might be made of fabric. A friend at church made this one for me, and it goes over your face like this. And we're wearing these right now to keep ourselves safe and keep ourselves protected during the pandemic. But I thought that with masks over our face, it can be kind of hard to recognize people sometimes. And that made me think of this week's gospel story. Because in the gospel story, Jesus' friends were walking with him on the road, but they didn't recognize that it was him. And they didn't realize that Jesus was with them until he sat down with them and they had a meal and they broke bread together. That's when they recognized him, when he did something familiar to them that made them realize who he was. And I was thinking, maybe you're not able to see people that you love, people that are familiar to you right now, and maybe you're missing them a little bit this week. And so I thought I would give you one of these. Your mom and dad have these in their email, and this is a portrait face. And what you can do with it is you can draw a picture of a person that you love, and you can include in there all of the things that are special and unique about that person that helps you recognize them. Draw what makes them special, the things that you love about them. Make this a precious picture for them and put it up somewhere and think of how much you love them until you can be together again. Thanks for joining us this week. We all love you so much, and we can't wait to have you back at Abiding Love.
I love the Emmaus story. I think it's one of the most powerful and profound stories in the whole of Scripture. It's filled with meaning and metaphor and all kinds of information for reflection in our time. It sits like a parable in Luke's gospel. Luke shares more Jesus parables than any of the other gospels by far. And the Emmaus story is shared in Luke alone. Two walkers, two people traveling on that first day. We're still on that first day of the week. On the same day it begins. Two disciples are walking along. One named Cleopas, we've never heard of him before. His name means highly renowned. The other completely anonymous. Could be any of us. But here they are walking. They'd been there with Jesus and the disciples in Jerusalem. They had been there during his tumultuous time in the city. They'd been there through his confrontations with the powers that be. They'd been there through his arrest, his torture and trials, his crucifixion. They'd been there this very morning on the first day when people came back from the tomb talking about empty tomb and grave clothes, talking about angelic visitations. Now on that same day, they're walking away. And it's a fair question, why? Maybe to get away. Perhaps to escape. The rest of the disciples, sequestered in the upper room, hiding out in legitimate fear, in danger of their lives. They were there when the women came back. They were there. Some of our people ran to the tomb. They said they didn't see him. We didn't go. And they're walking away. They're dejected. They're disappointed. And they're moving on. Luke says they're going to a place called Emmaus. It means hot springs. A town we've never heard of before. Never anywhere else in the Bible is it even mentioned. And yet, in Jesus' time, for the people of God, when they hear Emmaus, they hear victory ringing in the clear air. They hear freedom, liberation. We talked a little bit about Maccabees on Palm Sunday. We shared a Maccabees reading on Palm Sunday about a triumphant entry into Jerusalem 200 years before Jesus, when Judas Maccabeus and the victors from the battlefield re-enter the city, and people cut palm branches and wave them, and they sing hosannas, God save us. And Jesus' reenactment of that on Palm Sunday is poignant for the people that are gathered there. Maccabees is a book of the Apocrypha. It comes to us from that intertestamental time. Sadly, a lot of these apocryphal books are not in most Bibles. Good study Bibles will have them. And it's a period of four centuries of history that are in themselves tumultuous. This is the time of the rise of the Greek Empire, the Greek flashing over of the entire world, remaking the world in a Greek image, occupying and subjugating Palestine and God's people once again in a long line of oppressors. And yet, there is a significant battle, and this Maccabees reading recounts that victory, where the people actually rise and militarily defeat the Greeks on the battlefield and triumph, return to Jerusalem, proclaiming freedom for everyone. This is what resounds from this tumultuous battle. In their possession, the people of God cut branches, sang hymns and praises to heaven, for God is good and his mercy endures forever. And thus Israel had a great deliverance that day. They knew freedom for once in their lives. And the battle that took place that decided it all happened at a place called Hot Springs, Emmaus. These two disciples that we join on the road today are not walking away or moving on. They are returning. They are trying to go back to a time and a place where the people knew freedom, the last time they knew what it was to live as the free people of God without an oppressor hanging over them and sucking the life out of them. They are moving backward, attempting a reset, a restart, going back to the beginning. And as they travel along, another one joins them on the road. Luke calls him a peroika, which means a sojourner. This sojourner joins them on the road and gives them this astounding gift. He says to them, "Oh, how foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted things about himself in all of the scriptures. What an amazing Bible study. Oh, one of the places to be present in all of history to hear Jesus reflect on his entire life, death, and resurrection in the scope of the scriptures, Hebrew Testament and New. The sojourner interprets for them everything that God has revealed, all of the truth that God has shared. The risen Christ opens to them the meaning of Scripture, the law and the prophets and the writings framed in his ministry and in his life. And still, they don't recognize him. This one who said, "Lo, I am with you always, even to the end and beyond. Wherever you gather in my name, there I am also." And here he is present, and this profound, marvelous storytelling of the lack of recognition. It's at the table that Luke's rich crescendo in this story reaches its top, its peak. And it does so in a meal that remembers the last time they gathered with the risen, with Lord in the upper room. In this masterful painting by Caravaggio, when he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. And then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. As they reflect later on, on their renewed journey, this time back to Jerusalem, to a new beginning, forward into new days ahead. Were not our hearts burning within us when he traveled with us on the road while he was opening the scriptures to us? We're invited, like the Emmaus disciples, to awaken to the presence of Christ in our time, in all weathers. And sometimes when we find him most profoundly absent, to realize perhaps that it's a lack of recognition on our part. In the shining light of the resurrection, we know the promise of God, "Lo, I am with you always." Raised with him to new life for the sake of the world. Life teaches us that there is no going back. History, as it transpires in the moments and seasons of our lives, changes everything forever. Don't look back, the saying is. We're not going that way. But as people of the resurrection, we know that wherever we go, God goes with us. God is there before us. And the risen Christ's makes the journey as our sojourner, our fellow paroika on the road. And if we're looking with the eyes of the heart, with the eyes of compassion and humility, of grace and courage, we will see him and we will recognize him. Amen. The poet said, "May you live in interesting times," and we certainly do. This is a time when so many know feasts of abundance, and so many more know times of famine and real deprivation. One of the best antidotes to everything that besets us in this time is simply taking the opportunity to be generous, to live life from a grateful place, and to share blessing in every way that we can. For some, it's financial, for some, it's volunteerism. Other ways, other means of sharing God's grace, all are welcome in this time. Let us pray. God of abundance, in this season of celebration and thanksgiving, we bring to you the first fruits of our lives and livelihoods, celebrating the blossoming of your blessings in us. All that we are and all that we have are gifts from you. With grateful hearts, we offer our gifts, so that multiplied in your hand, they may flow forth in ministry and reach out to bless others. Amen.
Yeah, these old
As a community, we come together to share our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As a community of faith, we come together in prayer for each other and for the world. Let us pray. Lord God, God of love, God of joy, God of peace, and God of the resurrection, because of your greatest miracle, we have become Easter people. We thank you always for the gift of eternal life in you. God of all, hear our prayer. Today is a day to be all that we can be. We pray this day that you will keep us ever mindful of your love for us and your ever-present Spirit within us. We know that with you all things are possible. We ask that you continue to lift our spirits and help us to find ways in which we can share your love with others during this time in our lives. God of all, hear our prayer. We pray today for all those in need of healing. We lift them up by name to you now. We especially pray for all those who are suffering financially during this pandemic, not only here in this country, but in the countries all around the world. Give them a spirit of perseverance and lead us to help in any way we can to share your love for them. God of all,
hear our prayer.
We thank you, Lord, for all those in our faith community and beyond who continue to help fulfill the needs of those who are hungry. Bless them and keep them safe and healthy. God of all,
hear our prayer.
Lord, fill us with your love and joy and give us your peace. We pray together as our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You know, even sequestered as we are, life still has a way of being extraordinarily busy, and perhaps even more complex in these times. One of the blessed ways that we can remember to let our spirits catch up with us, and for us to catch up with the Holy Spirit, is to find places, ways, spaces of silence. Like the psalmist says today, be still. Be still and know that I am God. May God bless you and keep you. May God make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May God look on you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I love to tell the story of unseen things.
We go forth together,
sharing God's love.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.